ask the brothers to please fill in the gaps in front. It makes it easier for those who are coming later to find place to perform salah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه الغر الميامين أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والقرآن الحميد ولنبلونكم بشيء من الخوف والجوع ونقص من الأموال والأنفس والثمرات وبشر الصابرين وقال تبارك وتعالى الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا وهو العزيز الغفور صدق الله العظيم. Respected and most honorable ulama, Huffaz, brothers, elders, mothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has or will at certain times test his servants, and we will be made to go through certain trials and tribulations, and these hardships will come upon us. And the reason for this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةِ. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who created death and life. And al-hayata liyabluwakum ayyukum ahsanu amala, so that you may be tested a test will come upon you, which of you are best in deeds. Allah puts this test in front of us so that to test us and see that which of us will be better and which will come out with best deeds. My respected elders and friends, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a hadith makes mention, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ, that wondrous is the affairs of a believer. Wondrous is the affairs of a believer. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test him. And Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam says, إِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ سَرَّى شَكَرَ, that if a difficulty, if Allah blesses the person with some good ni'mat, with a good deed, with a blessing, then he becomes happy, wa shakara, and he makes shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa in asabathu dharra sabara fakana khayrun lah. And if a calamity and a difficulty befalls upon the person, then he perseveres, he exercises sabr, and that is better for him. My respected elders and friends, in another narration it is mentioned that Musab ibn Sa'id radiallahu ta'ala records, and he relates from his father, that we asked Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَيُّ النَّاسِ أَشَدُّ bala, O Nabi of Allah, which people are tested more by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, الأنبياء, the prophets, the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are tested more by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are given more trials and tests. And then ثُمَّ الْأَمْثَلُ فَالْأَمْثَلُ, and then those people who are closer to them and those people who are closer to them. My respected elders and friends, Ibn Qayyim rahimahumullah makes mention that look at the path of the Anbiya alayhi salatu was salam. From the time we find Adam alayhi salatu, the path is the path of which Adam exerted himself, the path of which Nuh alayhi salatu was salam wept, and Khalil Ibrahim alayhi salatu was salam was thrown in the fire. Ismail became Zabihullah. His life was laid down to be sacrificed. Yusuf alayhi salatu was salam was abandoned by his brothers. He was thrown in the bottom of a well, and then he was lifted from there, sold for a meager amount, became a slave, and then coming in the home of the minister, and from there he's taken in jail. He perseveres, and this is a great test upon him. And then comes, it is mentioned, Zakariya alayhi salatu wa salam, who was cut in two what they saw. And then Yahya alayhi salatu wa salam, who was slaughtered. Ayyub alayhi salatu wa salam, who suffered severe illness, who suffered such illness that he had to be taken out of the town. Nobody wanted to be near him. And we find studying the life of our beloved Habib al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What difficulty did Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam not go through? What difficulty did Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam not endure? It is mentioned when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received prophethood and he's brought in front of a person by the name of Waraqa ibn Nawfal, according to the narration of Sahih al-Bukhari. Waraqa ibn Nawfal said to him, Would that I were a young man. If I was young, I had some time, he was old already, then I would be alive to see you. I would be alive to see how the people will expel you. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam says, oh Waraqa, are you saying that the people will expel me from my very own home, from my very own hometown? Waraqa ibn Nawfal said, yes, no man has ever come with that which you have. No Nabi have come with that which you have. Meaning no Nabi, no Prophet was sent into this world, but he was faced with hostility. And what hostility from who? From his very own people. From his very own people. My respected elders and friends, just let us go through some of the incidents in the life of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam and match the difficulties that we are going through. Let us see what we are going through and see that how we can maybe steer our boat and see what we can do and see what Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam had done from the very beginning. From the very beginning, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam came into this world, he was born in a home. And prior to his birth, his father passes away. He is born as an orphan in the home of Amina. And then, we know, as according to the customary of the people of Makkah, he is now sent from his home. And people used to send their children to the outskirts of Makkah, to the Bedouins, so that they may be nurtured in that fresh air. And now when the people come, and all the ladies, and they have come to come and collect their children who they can suckle. And we find that a lady by the name of Halima Sa'diyah, radiallahu anha, she also joins this caravan. And each person, these ladies and their family, they come and they go to the home and find out that which children are there so that we may take back. And they go and they collect their children. And there's nobody who wants to take little Muhammad. There's nobody who wants to take our beloved Habib Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Halima Sa'diyah, because he was an orphan, they felt they will get nothing from here. Halima Sa'diyah, looking at it and thinking that I got nobody to take what, perhaps let me just take this orphan. Perhaps I'll get some barakah from this orphan. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is taken by Halima Sa'diyah. No sooner he is placed on the camel of Halima, that very camel, when they were coming to Makkah to come and fetch these boys, these young children, could not even move properly because of weakness. But when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is placed upon the camel, we find the camel is moving. It's like, you know, they added some nos to it. They could not keep up with this camel. That very same Halima, whose breasts were dried up, but when she places Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is filled with milk. The goats in the home of Halima, who did not have sufficient milk, who was lean, who was thin, who was weak, as soon as Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes into the home of Halima, the goats also start giving a lot of milk. This was the barakat, the blessings that Halima Sa'diyah radiallahu anha had seen. She thought that she's taking something which maybe does not have much, but this became the turning point in her life. And we find that that very same Halima now is blessed with great success. And everybody is looking up to her, that what has happened to you? And Allah had blessed her, that Halima Sa'diyah radiallahu anha, in later life, she accepts Iman upon the hands of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam, whenever he met her, he showed great affection to her. She is his mother. He used to call her the title, by my mother. And it is mentioned she passed away in Medina al-Munawwara. And we find that when we go to Jannatul Baqi, we visit the grave. And one of the graves we visit is the grave of Halima Sa'diyah radiallahu anha. Nevertheless, he returns from Halima Sa'diyah. He comes back to the home of his mom, Amina, Sayyidatina Amina. And we find that not very long after that, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam travels with his mother to Medina Munawwara, and we know Umm Ayman is with Umm Ayman is with, and they go to the place where she is going to visit the grave of her husband, the father of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, going to Medina Munawwara, and on return at a place called Abwa, she becomes ill because of the grief that she experiences due to the separation from her husband. It causes her demise. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, young boy at the age of 6, and he buries his mother, he sees his mother being buried, and now he returns back to Makkah without a mother as well. He returns back to Makkah without a mother as well. He comes in the company, and he's brought to be looked after by his grandfather, Abdul Muttalib. And not very long after that, Abdul Muttalib's shadow is also taken away from him. He also leaves this world. He also passes away. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam then is given and taken from one home to the other home. And now he's brought up in the home of Abu Talib, his beloved uncle. His beloved uncle. And we know that he spends the time in the home of Abu Talib until he reaches the age where now he is of a marriageable age. He goes for some business trips. He's married to the lady Khadija radiallahu anha, one of our mothers. And thereafter, spending time in the home of Khadija, Allah blesses them with children. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam receives prophethood. At the age of 40, he receives his prophethood. And we know then how, like Waraqa bin Nawfal prophesied and said, that your people will expel you, your people will abandon you. That is what happens. The very same people who loved Nabi alayhi salam. Imagine when Nabi sallallahu alayhi salam was born, his uncle Abu Lahab became so happy. He was extremely joyful upon the birth of his nephew in the home of his brother Abdullah, that he becomes ecstatic. And he frees his slave girl Suwayba immediately. Yet the very same person, when his nephew Muhammad, who was beloved to him at birth, comes to him and says, "Oh my uncle," and Allah commands him, وَأَنْذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, that go forward now and invite your close relatives to bring them to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From the first person who he gets hostility, from the first person who gives him the taklif and difficulty, is none other than the very same uncle Abu Lahab. That you have gathered us here. We know the whole incident when he gathered them while he was on Mount Safa and said that may you be destroyed. Tabbat laka, that may your hands perish. And Allah Ta'ala reveals the ayah, Tabbat yada abi lahabi wa tab. Now Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he goes, and after a while, we know the boycott which had taken place in the valley of Abu Talib, and spending a few years there, and then he comes out from there, and then after a few, that very same year is known as Aam-e Huzn, the year of difficulty, wherein, or the year of sadness, wherein Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's confidant, his life partner, his shoulder of support, our beloved mother, Sayyidina Khadija radiallahu anha, is taken away. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam has to endure, and he makes sabr. He does not complain to Allah. Khadija radiallahu anha passes away. After a short while, his uncle, Abu Talib, also a pillar of support. Although he did not accept Islam, yet he gave great support to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is mentioned, he passes away. Therefore, it is known as the Aam-e Huzn, the year of sadness. And now Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam decides, let me change my direction. And let me go towards the people of Taif. And we know Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes to Taif. He first goes to the chieftains of Taif. He invites them to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They do not respond to his call. And not only they do not respond to his call, they order the young boys and the slaves of Taif to pelt Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To pelt Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's virtually stoned out of the city of Taif. Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam is bleeding. Brothers, we can speak about it. You can hear about it. We can read about it. But we cannot fathom the difficulty Nabi alayhi salam went on that day. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is bleeding. It comes in the narrations to such an extent that his shoes become stuck to his feet due to the excessive blood which had happened. And now Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam finds a place to sit under a palm tree or under a tree. And suddenly it is said, a person, the two brothers, Utbah and Rabi'ah, the sons of Shaybah, they see and they witness this. and they tell the slave, Adas, that they felt him sorry, although their heart was hard, but they felt him sorry. And he says, oh, Adas, take this grape to the person who has been pelted. And Adas comes with the grapes. And he presents it to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam takes that grape and he says, Bismillah. Adas says, what did you say? Nobody uses this word here. So he asks Adas, who are you? He says, I'm Adas. From where do you come? Ninwa. He says, oh, that's the place of my brother, Yunus ibn Matta. How do you know Yunus? He says, Yunus is a prophet and I'm also a prophet. Yunus is a prophet and I'm also a prophet. Adas starts kissing the feet of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The masters are looking at, what is this person doing? And then he brings iman upon the hands of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My respected elders and friends, listen to the statement. Aisha radiallahu anha asked Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after the battle of Uhud. And we know the difficulty that Nabi alayhi salam went through in the battle of Uhud. His cheek, Mubarak, becomes injured. He loses two of his blessed teeth. He is bleeding. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Aisha radiallahu anha sees this, she says after the battle, oh Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, oh my beloved Habib, which was the most difficult day in your life? From all the difficulties which came upon you, which was the most difficult? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, oh Aisha, I endured great difficulty from your people, but the worst was the day I was pelted in Taif. Oh Aisha, the worst was the day I was pelted in Taif. Yet, when the angels come, Jibreel Amin descends. Zayd ibn Haritha is with Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jibreel alayhi salam says, oh Nabi of Allah, I have the angels who are in control of the mountains. I need your permission. Give us the permission. We will crush these people between the two mountains, the people of Taif. We are here. Give us the call. We are waiting for your command. What does Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do? Firstly, listen to the dua that Nabi alayhi salam makes. While he is sitting at the bottom and resting, Allahumma ilayka ashku dhu'fa quwwati wa qillata hilati. Look at it. It's a lengthy dua. I'm just bringing this 2 points, the beginning. Oh Allah, I complain to you of my infirmity and my inadequate strategies. He doesn't complain to Allah that, oh Allah, look what I had to endure because of your deen. Oh Allah, look at what the people have done to me. He says, oh Allah, it is because of my weakness, my inadequate strategy of inviting them. And then when the angel Jibreel asks permission, what does he say? No, do not destroy them. For perhaps if they did not take heed, if they did not accept my message, then Allah will create people from amongst their progenies who will accept my message. Then Allah will create people from amongst their progenies who will accept their message. Do not destroy them. Coming from returning, spending some time in Makkah, going through all the difficulties, now it is time that the command comes that because of the difficulties, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam has to leave Makkah, that place which is beloved, Makkah, which is a magnet. Any person who visits the Kaaba once, his heart is always there towards Kaaba Sharif. It is a magnet which attracts your heart towards Baytullah. You are not going there because of the Hilton. You are not going there because of the 5-star hotels. You are not going there because of the jewelry shops. You are going there because of Ka'batullah. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was born in Makkah. And when he's leaving Makkah, he's made to leave Makkah. He has to migrate from Makkah to Medina. Then he looks at Kaaba and he looks at Makkah and says, oh Makkah, you are beloved to me. If it was not because of the difficulty of your people or the people of Makkah, I would have not left you. I would have not left you. My respected elders and friends, we can go on talking about the difficulties in the life of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But Remember that every person, from the beginning of the talk I said, لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Allah Ta'ala puts this difficulties, this trial upon us to see that who is best with action. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنْفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَةِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. That Allah Ta'ala says that definitely I will test you with fear, with joy, with hunger. I will take away your sustenance, your children. وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. But glad tidings upon those who exercise patience. الَّذِينَ إِذَا when they get this difficulty, what do they say? إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Nabi alayhi salam has taught us that even at a loss of a shoelace, they say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. He was walking once and his shoelace broke, the sandal. So Nabi alayhi salam said, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Sahaba wa qarin said, you say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ for this. He says, whatever difficulty comes upon a person, you should recite, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. I read in one of the tafsirs that this particular verse, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ, was only given to this ummah. If you study the life of Yusuf alayhi salam, Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam, and you find that when they went through difficulty, what were the words? They did not recite Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. This is a gift to the ummah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in one place it is said, a person very beautifully said that never give up hope when you face a difficulty, because it might in fact be your road to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a window to His mercy. Never give up hope when you face any difficulty, for that may be a road for you towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a means of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descending upon you. My respected elders and friends, in one hadith, a Qudsi, and I would like to end off, I got very few minutes, but just how do we, if a difficulty comes upon us, how do we react and what should we do? What measures should we take? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in one hadith, he makes mention, is a hadith, a Qudsi, that call Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, إِنَّ مِنْ عِبَادِي مَنْ لَا يُسْلِحُ إِيمَانَهُ إِلَّا الْفَقْرِ وَلَوْ أَغْنَيْتَهُ لَأَفْسَدَهُ ذَلِكَ. That some of my servants, I place upon them poverty. For if I have to give them wealth, they will abandon me. إِنَّ مِنْ عِبَادِي مَنْ لَا يُسْلِحُ إِيمَانَهُ إِلَّا الْغِنَى. Certain of my servants, I give them wealth. For if I have to give them poverty, they will abandon me. إِنَّ مِنْ عِبَادِي مَنْ لَا يُسْلِحُ إِيمَانَهُ إِلَّا السَّقَمْ. They are certain of my servants that I give them sickness, for if I have to give them good health, they will abandon me. And they are certain of my servants, I give them good health, for if I have to give them sickness, they will abandon me. My respected elders and friends, first and foremost, let us see, look at the situation in today's time. Every second, we talk, anybody who's got an illness, you go to the doctor, what do they say? What do they attribute it to? You are going through stress. You are going through stress. If I just did a Google search this morning, according to the World Health Organization, more than 300 million people in today's time suffer from depression, which is like 5% of the entire population. And then in the USA, it is mentioned more than 75 people experience high level of moderate stress. You have stress from work, you have stress from home. Every person, what's happening? I'm going through stress. I imagine the difficulty which came to Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam. Would it not also give him some stress? But Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam knows and has taught us that Allah Ta'ala knows that He is testing us. But what should we do? Is it that we should sit back and say, no, I am depressed? No, or I am stressed? And then you blame every other thing? First and foremost, one should realize the most important aspect is to see our iman. When a difficulty comes upon us, are we happy with the condition that Allah has placed upon us? Are we not happy? If we are happy with the condition, when I say happy, we are contented, then remember that is a trial, it's a test for you. But if you are not happy, then that is an azab and a punishment for you. If you are not happy, that is an azab and a punishment. In one hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam giving some advice to Sayyidina Abu Huraira. He says, Abu Huraira, it is mentioned that it's a very famous hadith where five nasihat and advices were given to Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And the second is, وَرْضَ بِمَا قَسَمَ اللَّهُ لَكْ تَكُنْ أَغْنَى النَّاسِ. Be happy with the decree of Allah, you will be the most wealthiest of people. If you have contentment. It is mentioned, Sa'ad bin Abi Waqas radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, that people used to come to him. He was known as Mustajarul Da'wat. They used to say, oh Sa'ad, make dua for me. If they come in the morning, before the evening, his dua was accepted in their favor. So people used to come. Towards the latter portion of his life, he became blind. Someone asked him, oh Sa'ad, you are making dua for everybody, why don't you make dua for yourself that Allah should restore your sight? He says, I am happy with which Allah has kept me. Allah has written blindness for me, I am happy for that. I am happy with that condition that Allah has kept me in this state. I will not ask Allah to change my condition. My respected elders and friends, the first thing is that we should connect with Quran. When difficulty comes upon ourselves, when we find that we are going through some difficulty, some depression, you know, they say you go to the doctor and you get an antidepressant. You know what's an antidepressant? With respect to all our medical practitioners. What's an antidepressant? Our colleague Mona Sulaiman Mullah says an antidepressant is just like when you have a problem in your car. You go to the mechanic. You know what is a noise in the car from the back on the left, right side? You try to sort it out. After 3 days, you go again. No, man, this thing is not sorted out. Okay, try something else. He checks up the car, he tries, no, try it again. You drive for a while, stops, no, it's coming back again. Now it's even louder. Until you go the fourth time, and what do you say? I got a solution for you. What is it? You know, when you're driving, then pump up the volume of your radio. You won't hear it. That is an antidepressant. That is an antidepressant. For a short while, it's helping us. But then we're back to square one. Bring faith in Allah. Ista'inu. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention that if you want, then seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with prayer. Ista'inu billah, that take the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with sabr, with salah and sabr, meaning perform extra rakat in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, my respected elders and friends, and this is one of the many reasons, I'll end off on this. There's a beautiful dua as well, the time does not permit. I'll end off with this one quote of Aun bin Abdullah. In Tirmidhi Sharif also it is mentioned. It is Sahibtul Aghniya, falam yakun aharin atwalu ghamman minni. That I used to spend time with the affluent people. I used to spend time with the Joneses. I used to move around with them. But I didn't find anyone who was more stressful and more saddened than myself. Why? فَإِنْ رَأَيْتُ رَجُلًا أَحْسَنَ ثِيَابًا مِنِّي. Because when I used to spend time with them, I always saw somebody wearing a better garment than me. What are you wearing? Oh, that's a Louis Vuitton. Oh, that? Oh, that is this. I don't know all the names. But... And every time you're with somebody, and our youth should take heed of it, that they've got this, they bought that brand, they got this new shoe, and then it comes with وَأَتْيَبُ رِيحًا مِنِّي. They got the best of perfume, better perfume than mine, and better conveyance than mine. Oh, he bought the latest BM. He's the first to get the 5 series. He's the first to get this series. He was the first to get this brand of car. And as we go every day, and we're sitting amongst these people, what is it? Only money. You know what? Let's go and buy this. I'm going for a golf match to here, and we're flying to Mauritius, and you don't have it, what you decide? You're just sitting there, and your mouth is watering. So Aun bin Abdullah says that فَصَحِبْتُ الْفُقَرَىٰ. I changed my gatherings. I started spending time with the poor. فَاسْتَرَحْتُ. I started becoming happy. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us from the hadith that when it comes to worldly matters, then look at those who have less than you. If you think you are going through difficulty, you don't have a shoe, and then you will see a person without any feet, you will say, Alhamdulillah, I've got feet, but I don't have shoes. This person has no, he's got no feet, he cannot even wear a shoe. So when it comes to matters of this world, then look at those who have less than you. I've got a Toyota. Yes, it's an 80 model, but it's taking me from A to B. This person doesn't even have that. And when it comes to matters of deen, then look at those. Don't be content. No, I at least come for Jummah namaz. Because Jummah comes so fast, so I think I'm a Babul Musalli. Jummah comes so fast, one Friday to the next. So I'm like a Babul Musalli. Look at the person who's performing more than you. Why is it that I'm not at the time of Asr? Why is it that I'm not here at the time of Fajr? Why is it that I'm not here at this time? Why is it that he's reading more Quran? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the opportunity, my respected elders and friends. There are many du'as to recite, and one of the easy du'as, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-hammi wal-huzn, wa na'udhu bika min al-adzi wal-kasr, wa na'udhu bika min al-jubni wal-bukh, wa na'udhu bika min ghalabati al-dayni wa qahri al-rijal. Learn this du'a, recite it, and inshallah, if time permits, on some other occasion, we'll discuss other du'as. Wa sallallahu ta'ala ala al-Nabi al-Kareem, wa ala alihi wa sahabihi ajma'in, subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim.